Welcome back. This is chapter 16.3 of the digestive system, focusing on the pharynx or the throat, commonly called the throat. Pharynx serves as a common passageway for food, liquid, and air. We did see the anatomy and some physiology, histology of the pharynx in chapter 15 on the respiratory system. But the pharynx is divided into three portions: the nasopharynx, at the posterior or dorsal end of the nasal cavity, the oropharynx at the posterior side of the oral cavity, and the laryngopharynx, which is the distal portion of the pharynx. We are mostly only concerned with the oropharynx and laryngopharynx here because those are the only portions of the pharynx that food should pass through. Of course, it occasionally does move into the nasal cavity, but food passes primarily through the oropharynx and laryngopharynx. And for that reason, the mucosa here is a little different in these portions of the pharynx, the oropharynx and laryngopharynx, compared to the nasopharynx, because these portions have to deal with the abrasion of food. Therefore, the squamous epithelium is a stratified squamous epithelium. Deep to the epithelium, the lamina propria has mucus glands and several sets of tonsils we'll see on the upcoming slides. The muscles of the pharynx cooperate with the oral cavity and the muscles of the esophagus in the swallowing reflex. And we're going to talk about the swallowing reflex in a moment, just after we talk about some of the anatomy and physiology of the esophagus. The esophagus is a muscular tube that connects the pharynx to the stomach. It is about 25 centimeters long and only 2 centimeters wide. In fact, it's often collapsed unless food is passing through it, and so the lumen is not obvious unless food is, or the bolus is, making its way down the esophagus. But it sits behind the windpipe or the trachea and passes through the thoracic cavity into the abdominal cavity within the mediastinum and then through the diaphragm. And the portion of the esophagus that goes through the diaphragm, that region is called the esophageal hiatus. And it's a small opening that the esophagus fits through that should not allow other organs to come from the abdominal cavity up into the thoracic cavity. That does occur sometimes. We call this a diaphragmatic or hiatal or hernia. Hiatal hernia. And so it's a movement of abdominal organs or portions of the organs upward through the esophageal hiatus. It does happen actually somewhat commonly, but it's not usually that problematic unless it starts to displace or put pressure on the thoracic organs, and then it often needs to be dealt with. But the esophagus, the epithelium of the esophagus, is lined with a stratified squamous epithelium for obvious reasons. It has to deal with abrasion of a bolus that runs along the length of this narrow tube that physically is in contact with the epithelium at all times. And it is surrounded with smooth muscle, just as the rest of the digestive system. But the upper third of the pharynx and the upper third of the esophagus actually have skeletal muscle. And then that skeletal muscle starts to blend in with smooth muscle in the middle third of the esophagus, and the final third of the esophagus, proximal to the stomach, is completely smooth muscle. So you actually see a blending of smooth and skeletal muscle at the top of the upper third or second third of the esophagus, and at the upper portion end of the esophagus and the distal end of the esophagus, we have sphincters where the circular muscles form, and the lower esophageal sphincter is actually constantly in contraction. Now, it's not a perfect sphincter. Parts of the bolus, chyme, acids, whatnot from the stomach can rise up into the esophagus under certain cases if food is digested too quickly or there's too much food in the stomach or certain physical impacts and so on can cause the acids and whatnot to return into the esophagus. The esophagus is very sensitive to these acids, very painful, so we call this acid reflux. And our gastrointestinal reflux disorder can occur. In fact, the industries that take care of acid reflux that produce antacids is a multi-million or multi-billion dollar industry now because of the commonality of this. And this is a common problem, especially in cases of obesity or for other genetic reasons. The movement of food from the oral cavity down the pharynx into the esophagus or swallowing is called deglutition. Deglutition is a very complex process, and it is initiated voluntarily, and it can happen involuntarily as well. But it goes through several phases, and only the initial phase is the buccal phase is really under complete voluntary control. The rest are under involuntary control. But once it's initiated, it continues fully automatically. So the tongue forms the food into a small mass called a bolus, and it is actually the compression by the tongue of the bolus against the hard palate, and there are these arches called palatal arches there along the perimeter of the oral cavity where neurons are sensitive to this pressure and initiate the swallowing process. So the swallowing process goes through several phases. We're going to see on the next slide images of this, the buccal phase, the pharyngeal phase, and the esophageal phase. So I'm going to skip ahead to the images that illustrates these phases. So you can get these points here, or you can see them also along with the images on the next slide. But the buccal phase begins with the compression of the bolus against the hard palate and the palatal arches found there. And retraction of the tongue forces the bolus into the oral pharynx and actually helps assist in elevating, pushing, this is the bolus here in kind of the yellowish goldish color here, pushing the soft palate up, which blocks passageway into the nasal cavity. So the nasal pharynx is sealed off. Once the bolus enters the oral pharynx, the reflex response begins and the bolus is moved towards the stomach. All right, so this becomes then a reflex that is under involuntary control. But at this time, you can see that the passageway into the trachea is still open. The epiglottis is still elevated. And so there still is opening for air to move into the trachea. As we move into the pharyngeal phase, you see that changes. The pharyngeal phase begins as the bolus comes in contact with the palatal arches and the posterior pharyngeal wall. And the larynx, as we learned in chapter 15, actually elevates. Sorry, my cursor is stuck. The larynx elevates, and that causes the epiglottis to fold over, blocking passageway into the trachea. So the bolus or any liquids that are in the oral cavity and the pharynx do not move into the trachea. At the same time, the uvula and soft palate block passageway back to the narrow nasopharynx still. The esophageal phase begins as contraction of the pharyngeal muscles force the bolus through the entrance into the esophagus. And notice how the esophagus is very closed off at this point until these muscles work and push the bolus into the esophagus. Once in the esophagus, the bolus is pushed towards the stomach. Now peristalsis takes over, which we learned a bit at the end of 16.1. And then eventually, as you can see, the esophagus travels down. This is the portion I was referring to earlier where the esophagus goes through the diaphragm. So the diaphragm is denoted here by this orange line, this muscular sheet. So we have a lower esophageal sphincter, and this is the hiatal hernias can occur, where we have that esophageal hiatus as it moves through the diaphragm. And this represents the upper portion of the stomach not drawn to its actual anatomical shape. But this is actually from a sagittal plane, so it's from the side here, looking at the stomach as the bolus moves into the upper portion. The esophagus actually attaches to the cardia of the stomach, but there is a higher portion called the fundus, and we'll talk about those in the section on the stomach coming up shortly.